Why do we need to fix the humanitarian aid system? This is the University of the Netherlands.
When I mention the term humanitarian aid, I think all of you have images in front of you because you watch the news. So you think of those white Toyotas with the Red Cross. You see people in refugee camps, fully packed, who are being given aid by some really nice young folks that hand out packages to them. But do we really know how this aid is organized? And do we know what the challenges are, what the problems are that is happening in aid? You don't. Good, I'm here not for nothing. So what are the problems that aid has, and how is the system ready to fix those problems? Now, that's what I want to talk with you about tonight. And the way and why I can do it is because for the last 20 years, I've been doing a lot of research together with colleagues in humanitarian assistance. So, for example, after the tsunami in 2004, I was in Sri Lanka. But I've always also followed what happened in Congo, South Sudan, Afghanistan, many of those places. So it is from there that I've seen how the system is going through some really profound changes. Now, at this very moment, there are an estimated 135 million people that depend on humanitarian aid for their survival. 135 million, that is around 2 times the whole population of France. Now, almost half of those people, they stay at home. They just try to live through conflict, disaster, with whatever means they can. And they're really grateful for aid that comes by and helps them to cope. Slightly the other half, more than the other half, those are people who have to actually leave their houses. So they have to go to a safer place, either in the country or a refugee camp. And that's where they stay sometimes for decades. Now, so that is how important humanitarian aid is. It's this responsibility for this 135 million people. And then what we also see is that because of climate change, the scenarios are that it won't stay with 135 million. We're thinking that in the near future, the amount, the number of people that will be depending on aid for their survival will grow a lot, because climate change destroys many environments, makes it unlivable for people to stay there, and many people have to move, perhaps even permanently. For example, when your village is washed away by a current of the river, you can't wait it out, you have to just go and never come back. So there is a big challenges to humanitarian assistance, especially if we look at the future, and therefore the question of my lecture is, why do we need to fix the humanitarian system? How can we do it? Now, before we can answer that question, I think we have to look a little bit where aid comes from. And of course, I think it's part of human beings. It's that we want to help people when they're in real trouble. You also do that with your friends. Every society has done that forever. But when we talk about humanitarian aid, modern humanitarian aid, we usually locate it in 1859, when there was this fellow, Henri Dunant. He was at a battlefield in Italy, Solferino, and he saw how it was on the battlefield and how many people were wounded and then not being taken care of. So a small wound could mean that you had to die. So he got engaged in the help, in the aid, in the makeshift hospitals. And when he got home, back to Geneva, where he's from, he thought more about it, what can be done to help people who are in trouble, especially during conflict. That was his mindset. So he talked to the governments of his day. And one of the things he got done is that those governments started to develop the Geneva Conventions for international humanitarian law. Now, that is not so relevant for the lecture today, but what he also did is he founded the International Committee of the Red Cross, the first real humanitarian agency. Now, 150 years later, more or less, we see that many things have changed, as I have already told you. Humanitarian aid has become a multi-billion dollar business with thousands of agencies implied. But still, for almost 150 years, the basic ideas of Henri Dunant from Solferino haven't really changed. So what are those basics? What was in the mind of Henri Dunant, how they set up the humanitarian system? First, there was the assumption that crises are exceptional and temporary. So it's only one moment that you have a problem. and then you can go back to normality. And it's not everywhere. It is in a specific time and place. Now, because it's temporary and because it's exceptional, you can bring in aid from the outside. So this is how we have evolved an international system from the United Nations, the Red Cross, and then even the NGOs, the big NGOs, you know them, like Médecins Sans Frontières, the International Rescue Committee, and Oxfam, and all those. Those are the agencies that organize humanitarian aid, and whenever there is a disaster or a conflict, they would come in from outside to help. So that's an externally driven system. And thirdly, it is all around principles, and that's the idea of the principle of humanity, the desire to preserve life, relieve suffering wherever it's found. But it also means it's like a non-interference kind of idea. So humanitarian aid comes in, it saves your life, and it goes out again. So it cannot solve the other problems that might have been there causing the crisis in the first place. And when we see today's crisis, they just don't fit that picture of temporary and exceptional. If we see today's crisis, just think of, I don't know, Afghanistan, Congo, crisis that lasts for decades and decades and decades. In South Sudan, it's already 50 years crisis. Now, the other issue is that because of this outside help coming in quick fixes, humanitarian aid is very expensive. And we have seen the numbers of people in need rise over the decades. And what we see is that in 1990, only $3 billion was used and given by governments, donor countries, for humanitarian assistance. That has grown and grown and grown. And in 2018, just 28 years later, we see it is $22 billion. And that's only the donor countries. If we add the private donations that people give, it's even $28 billion that is now being spent on humanitarian assistance on a yearly basis. It's a huge amount of money. I mean, you can say, wow, that's great. So that is solidarity. Well, to be honest, it's not just solidarity, because countries also give humanitarian aid for all kinds of political reasons. If we look at Europe, we often give humanitarian aid, so we hope these people won't come to Europe as refugees, for example. So there's lots of politics involved. But nonetheless, you can say, wow, that's great that we have that money to save people's lives. But that money is coming from somewhere. And very often those budgets for humanitarian aid are taken out of the budget that is available for development assistance. So what we then see is almost like a downward spiral, because the conditions for development, we don't have so much money left for. As a result, we get increasing crisis. Hence, we need even more money for humanitarian aid at the expense of even more development budgets. So that's not very good. This has been a mounting issue, as I mentioned, since 1990. It's been growing and growing and growing. But it has taken until 2016 until the system was really ready to change. There are enormous amount of crisis in those days. We have the Syria crisis, huge, many refugees. But also in those days, it's the wars in the Central African Republic, in South Sudan, in Congo. They're all flaring back up, asking tremendous attention, creating lots of refugees, etc., etc. Then we have Haiyan in the Philippines, the big storm, you remember. And on top of all that, Ebola in West Africa. So the humanitarian system was somehow cracking. It couldn't handle it, hardly handle it, organizationally, financially. And then the stories also came of the climate change folks starting to warn, hey, this is not even it. In the future, we predict even more people who are in need of humanitarian aid. So I think that is why the humanitarian system finally felt we really have to fix something, and was ready to listen to the critiques, really listen, because there were also critiques on the system. There was a pressure from below to change. And if I summarize the critiques that we had on humanitarian aid in the decades preceding 2016, it is captured in the word arrogance. Many people felt that humanitarian aid was a very arrogant business. First, with the people it serves, they always talk about victims. Very undignified way of looking at people. We are here to help you. You cannot help yourself. You need us to help you. Secondly, with other people, other actors, organizations in the societies where disaster happens. I saw that happening myself in 24 when I was in Sri Lanka after the tsunami. There were local organizations that coordinated the whole response to the tsunami, and they did a great job, I think. It took the international, UN, etc., 3-4 weeks to arrive and settle in. But once they were there, they were saying something like, okay, move to the site. Thank you for your efforts. Now we are here and we are the professionals. We come to take over. So that is why people thought that humanitarian aid was also rather arrogant. So in 2016, there was a big gathering organized by the United Nations. What can we do to fix the system? And here, the system came up with two fixes, you might say. So the two fixes are resilience and localization. Now the first, resilience. I see some of you perhaps old enough to remember the 1970s and 1980s. And in those days, there was this very popular slogan that said, if you give a man a fish, you feed him for a day. But if you give him a rod, you can feed him for a lifetime because he can catch his own fish. Now, that type of thinking is also embedded in the idea of resilience. People don't lose their skills. They still have their professional skills. They have their knowledge and everything. So you build on that. As much as possible, you try to facilitate that people help themselves. For example, in camps, you just bring people together and you feed them. Shelter, covers, oil, rice, whatever they need. But it's not very dignified, is it? People don't want to sit in a camp and not continue their life and not have their family life, their work, being able to travel and things like that. So it's much better if people cannot, don't need to be in a camp, but can manage themselves and just get aid to the extent that they don't need it. So it's tailored to what they need and don't need. So that is the idea of resilience. And we now see many countries, I mean, Uganda, Tanzania, Kenya, Ethiopia, many more that have now policies. Okay, let's close those camps. We give people some land, allow them to grow their own food, live in villages with our local populations. We close the camps. Now, the second fixer that is introduced is the idea of localization. Of course, we already had many local agencies that were there to provide humanitarian assistance, but they were not seen very well by the international community. And for example, all the money that is going around in humanitarian aid, in 2018, only 3% went directly to local governments and local organizations. Otherwise, it's local people who do the work. But they work for international organizations, the decisions are made in headquarters, very unequal system that people really resent. So localization is also the idea that you, as much as possible, you respect that it's the responsibility of local folks to help the people in their own country, the government, also other actors, and you try to facilitate it. You try to help them to create a capacity that they can deal with this humanitarian crisis. Those are the fixes that the humanitarian system has come up with and try to put into practice. However, not the end of story. Humanitarian aid is not a fairy tale, so there's no like, now we live happily ever after kind of situation. No, I'm actually quite concerned. I can see resilience, localization, the good side of it. But there are also some dangers and some risks and some questions that keep popping up in my mind all the time when I think about these things. One, if we start to think of crisis as something normal, something that just happens, who is going to think about how we solve the crisis? Do we really want a world where so many people are sort of semi-permanently at the brink of hardly surviving? Or can we find the energy to actually think what is the cause of those crises and how can we solve them and re-energize the efforts for development so that these crises will not occur? Secondly, when we talk about resilience, it's of course beautiful that we recognize the capacities of people to survive and their desire to take care of themselves and to work rather than hold up your hand for aid. But resilience can also become an excuse to say, oh, look, those people are really resilient, lovely. We don't need to help them anymore. And then it can turn into its opposite, abandonment, a of people rather than being resilient. Third, localization. I see localization as a really important issue as long as we think in terms of shared responsibility. But is it really a shared responsibility? Or are we going to think, oh, those people can solve it, they have their own organizations, we don't need to be responsible anymore? And are we not accidentally continuing the erosion of solidarity that we already see a bit happening in our societies, because we don't care so much anymore about refugees. We don't care so much anymore about all those people that are drowning in the Mediterranean trying to get to Europe, and they need our solidarity. So those are the three questions that are really, really on my mind. Now, my conclusion. Why do we need to fix the humanitarian aid system? I think I told you why. Because the crises we now see today are different. They last longer, they're not so exceptional, and you can't just get away with that old system of flying in the doctors that we have had since 1859. It's just not doable and flexible enough to deal with today's problems. And I really am still very motivated to continue my research into humanitarian aid, to follow how this evolves and where those problems don't really occur. At the same time, I want to appeal to all of you, because science alone cannot fix humanitarian aid. As I mentioned, the biggest danger I see is that in the end, there is an erosion of solidarity, and that people of privileged lives somehow forget to care anymore about the people who don't. Bad luck that you're born in that country where there's always hunger. And I think if we want to maintain that level of solidarity, I can help a bit as scientist, but it's something that all of us have to do, that how we can maintain the idea of solidarity, that we actually keep caring about people who need us. Thank you.